We have to know that we are all equal, not someone better than the other, but all of us, we are from Ummat al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are all the same. We cannot say this one is a scholar and this one is a listener. Might be a listener to Allah is better than the scholar. It depends on the heart of people. As Prophet ﷺ said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not look at your pictures, but He looks at your heart. And that's why it is very important to say that whatever I'm saying, I need it also as you might need it. I'm not more than you, might be I am less than you. And that's why we have to be always working as, not as a teacher and a student, or a scholar and a listener, or a lecturer and audience, but all of us, we are on the same level. A good speaker is the one that makes everyone their eyes open, their hearts open. A speaker that sees himself and becomes arrogant, that one, his speeches has no light, cannot reach the heart of the listeners. And it is very simple example. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has sent his sahaba everywhere around the world. And one time I was in Central Asia and they told me there is a grave here which is near China. There is a grave of a sahaba, and he was one of the cousins of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. His name is Qusum ibn al-Abbas. Prophet used to describe him as if he is his twin. He looks like Prophet, his features. He is a sahabi. But his features look the same. He was carrying that nobility, that he was carrying that reflection of heavenly power that Prophet ﷺ was dressing. He was reflecting on his cousin, Qusum ibn al-Abbas. And Prophet ﷺ mentioned a hadith about him, that he looks like me and his characters are like me. And it is written above his grave, hadith of Prophet. What I want to say is that at that time, a Sahabi going nearly the border of China to be a messenger or a diplomat raising the flag of Islam there. And it's amazing that he didn't know the language, he didn't know the culture, but because of the light that it is in his heart, he was able to convert all these people. people into Islam. How Sahaba were able to communicate? There must be a secret of communication. What you call it today in the technical language of today people, they say it is a telepathy. Telepathy means a communication without a telephone, from heart to heart. There are some people that they can speak from heart to heart. That Sahabi, with no oil money, with no television, with no satellites, with no books, was able to convert, with no language, was able to convey the message of Islam through his heart. They were looking at him and they were able to see that light in his face. Immediately they surrendering and they said that we want to be like you, enter into Islam, saying Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. So it is not the language that made the scholar a scholar. It is not the education that make the scholar a scholar. Is the character, is the manners. Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu wa ardah, when he became Amir al-Mu'mineen, when he became Khalifa after Sayyidina Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, everyone was happy. And he came to his house. Entering his house, he was crying. And might be some people, they cry from happiness. If we understand that something comes good and they begin to cry. But he was crying from something else. He was crying like a child. And his wife said, "Ya Omar, why you are crying?" He said, "I'm crying, I'm afraid and fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala." She said, "How? Allah is happy with you. You became today Amir al-Mu'mineen, the Khalifa of Muslims. Khalifa to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam." He said, "That's why I am afraid." She said, "Why are you afraid?" He said, "Today I am carrying the responsibility of everyone that say Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. If someone in the jungle is hungry, I'm responsible. If someone in the jungle is homeless, I'm responsible. If someone is killed, I am responsible. What I'm going to say to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in judgment day when he will ask me, 'Ya Omar, why that one was hungry? Why you didn't deliver food for him? Why that one has no shelter? Why you didn't give him a shelter? Why this one was killed? Why you didn't give him a safe haven?' It is my responsibility." Look, the taste, as we were saying in Jum'ah, the taste of Islam is not only a dry form praying, like I said, I gave an example of the mosque. That the mosque is a structure, nice structure, but it is like a warehouse when there is no worshippers, when there is no people coming and worshipping from different races, different colors, uniting them one thing, the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it makes the masjid decorated. So the good manners is what counts. Not only learning the letters that they are there without understanding their meanings. There was a very famous scholar from Morocco. His name is Ibn Ajiba. He said that knowledge is of two kinds. Ilm al-awraq wa ilm al-adhwaq. Knowledge of letters and knowledge of taste. Knowledge of letters, everyone can read. Can read papers, can read pages and pages and pages and pages. But the practice, what you need. The experience, what you need. The taste, what we need. So Qusb ibn al-Abbas was giving the Sahaba, was giving the people of Central Asia a taste that he was feeling it in himself, that he received it from Prophet ﷺ from heart to heart. And he's reflecting it to the people who are listening. And don't say, no, it cannot be possible in Islam. There is no such thing from heart to heart. Why? The example is very obvious in Islam. The example of Sayyidina Umar Ansariyah. When Sayyidina Umar was in Medina giving the Friday Jum'ah, and the general in command in Damascus fighting against the aggressors, Sayyidina Umar was able to see him from Medina to Damascus, what is known today as Syria, around 1,500 kilometers, around 1,000 miles. He spoke with him and he saw him. And Sariya was hearing Sayyidina Umar. Sayyidina Umar is saying to him, Ya Sariya al-Jabal, come, go to the mountain, be careful. Make sure your mountain is safe. They might come from the back. And Sariya was hearing. And those who around Sariya were hearing Sayyidina Umar's voice. Sayyidina Umar was seeing and sending the message. So means pious and sincere people, if we follow the footsteps of Sahaba, we will be able to reach the footsteps of Prophet ﷺ. Not everything is me, or myself. Prophet ﷺ never said myself. He never said nafsi. Everyone in Judgment Day, even prophets other than Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, they will say nafsi. Myself, Ya Rabbi, save me. Except Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that he says, my ummah, ummati. Ya Rabbi, ummati, before me. When Israel alayhi salam and Jibreel, they go to Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, calling him to the day of resurrection from Medina to Munawwara. First question he asked them, did Allah call my ummah or I am the first one to be called? They said, no, Ya Rasulallah. Don't worry. No one is being called. You are the first one to be called. Because he wants to make sure that his ummah is saved. He wants to make sure that his ummah will go to paradise. That's why he said in the famous hadith, Ana Sayyid Walad Adam, I am the master of the children of Adam. He said, Adam wa man dunahu tahta liwa'i yawm al-qiyamah. Adam who and whoever be under Adam is under my flag in the day of judgment. It is said in the ahadith that all prophets, every nation goes to its prophet. And they said, they asked them intercession. And all prophets and their nation, they come to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for intercession. And Allah will give him shafa'ah. مَنْ الَّذِي يَشْفَعُ عِنْدَهُ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِهِ. When Allah gives shafa'ah to Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what do you think? Prophet is going to leave anyone behind? There is hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari that says that in the day of judgment, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he will go into sajda. And he said that I make sajda, and Allah opened to my heart du'as that never ever came to me before. You know, if you read the ahadith of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there are a lot of du'as that we memorize. Everyone repeat them and everyone recite them in different ways after every prayer. Everyone learns some. What we call it al-adi al-ma'thura, or al-du'a al-ma'thura, or al-ma'thura. They recommended du'as that Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to use them to pray, to ask in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How many du'as? Thousands of them that's been written in books from Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam through Sahaba. And Prophet is saying in the hadith that Allah will open for me something that never been opened to me before, du'as that never I heard about it or imagined it. What kind of language then? What kind of language Allah give to him? Allah, we know that the language is the Arabic language. But what kind of words Allah gave Prophet ﷺ in that sajda? We don't know, no one knows. And Prophet ﷺ said, I don't know. Allah will open for me in that sajda. I make dua to Allah, I make dua, he's revealing to me duas. And I am asking him through this dua, and then he say, raise your head, ask, you will be given. And he say, Ya Rabbi, my ummah. What I want is my ummah. Like someone has children, and first of he looks after his children, where they are they safe or not? Especially in areas where there is too much crime, every husband or wife look after her children or his children, are they safe or not? Prophet ﷺ is looking after his ummah, are they safe or not? He's saying, Ya Rabbi, I need my ummah, give me my ummah. And Allah says, Ya Muhammad ﷺ, sell du'a, ask, you will be given. He say, Ya Rabbi, give me my ummah. He said, okay, take one third. And Allah will give him one third. We go to paradise with the shafa'ah of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But in the eyes of Prophet, as he said in the hadith, "Al-nasu sawasiyatun ka asnan al-mushk." People are equal, like the teeth of the comb are equal. So Prophet is happy he took one third. He, with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala permission, Allah gave him one third, but he wants the others. Then he goes into sajda another time. And he said that Allah will open for me dua that he did not open before. Not open in the first sajda. These are different. I keep making dua, I keep making dua, I keep making dua. We don't know for how long Prophet ﷺ will be in sajda. No one knows. Prophet never mentioned. Might be one moment, might be 1 year, in heavenly years, might be 1 million years, we don't know. And then Allah says, Ya Muhammad, raise your head, ask, you will be given. Say, Ya Rabbi, my ummah. He said, take half of the rest. Means one third from the total. He said one third goes to paradise. Then I go for sajda another time. And ask, Ya Rabbi, new du'as you will open for me that you didn't open before. I say, Ya Rabbi. He say, ask, you will be given. I say, I need the rest. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give him all the rest without one. He keeps one. And say, take them and go to paradise. And then that one looking, he is left behind. And Allah look at him and say, سَبَقَتْ رَحْمَةِ عَلَىٰ غَضَبِ. My mercy preceded my anger. My mercy overcame my anger. My mercy override my anger. Go with them, you are excused. And he sent everyone to paradise.
نَارَيْ تَكْبِيرٌ
Allahu Akbar!
نَارَيْ رَسَالَةٌ
يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ
That is an example of the care of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that he reflected in his Sahaba, and we see this in Sayyidina Umar, and of course with Sayyidina Abu Bakr, Sayyidina Uthman, Sayyidina Ali, and the rest. And we see that he is crying, telling his wife, if someone is going to be hungry, I'm responsible. No one else is going to be responsible. Today, do we care or we are not caring? We don't say we are not caring, and we don't say we are caring. We say we are struggling in between. Sometimes we care, sometimes we don't care. The pain is, no one feels it except the one who is being in pain. If you have, inshallah not, but if anyone has a sickness, he is the only one feeling the sickness, not anyone else. So that is yet not the highest level of faith. The highest level of faith is, if you have pain, I have pain. If you have problem, that problem will reflect on me. Means to feel with others. Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was feeling with everyone. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَعْلَمُوا أَنَّ فِيكُمْ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. You have to know that Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is among you, is between you, is in you.
Subhanallah.
He is rahmatan lil alameen. He is the mercy for humanity. That we have to learn from him. And that's why he asked one time Sahaba, he asked them to define for him. The question was, man in muflis. Man in muflis means, muflis in Arabic, the one who is, two meanings, the one who is poor, very poor, and the one who is being bankrupted. We say muflis. So he said, who is the muflis? Give me the definition of a muflis. And they said, Ya Rasulullah, the definition of a Muslim, of a muflis, means someone who has no money, who has no wealth, he has nothing. He is bankrupt. And Prophet looked at them and said, no. That is not the meaning. Although in Arabic literature, it is the meaning. It is that meaning. But Prophet wants to give us the meaning that is behind the word. And he said, Al-Muflisu man la amala lah. Look, the Sahaba, their vision went into dunya. They said, the one who is bankrupted means he doesn't have anything from the pleasure of dunya. He doesn't have wealth. Prophet went for the akhirah. He said, the one who is muflis, bankrupted, or no wealth, means the one who has no amal. Man la amal ala. And they said, Ya Rasulullah, how no amal? He is praying and fasting. He said, walau sam, walau salla, walau sam, walau salla. Even if he is fasting or praying, he has no amal. That is the bankrupt. That's big. How you are, people are praying and fasting, and Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying, they have no amal. Means, might be a quick question mark, that these people might go to hellfire. Because there is no amal. But they are praying and fasting. So what is the meaning then? He said, in the day of judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will call for example, two people. And the oppressed and the oppressor. Both of them, they pray, both of them, they fast. Both of them from Ummat al-Nabi. And you will ask the oppressor, the oppressed. The oppressed, who is? Do you need any right from your brother who oppressed you? He said, Naam ya Rabbi, I want my right, he oppressed me in dunya. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take from the hasanat, from the amal of that person, from his fasting and from his praying, and give the one who is being oppressed. But it is not enough. He takes all his amal and it's not enough. Then that person, the oppressor, will become with no amal. Nothing being written for him anymore. So he deserves what? He deserves hellfire. Then the oppressor will say, Ya Rabbi, the oppressed will say, Ya Rabbi, it's not enough, I need more. He did harm to me in dunya more. Then Allah will take from the bad amal of that one who was being oppressed and give the oppressor. Take his sayyat and give to the oppressor. So the oppressor become no amal with increased sayyat. And that's why Prophet ﷺ said, the one that al-muflis, the bankrupted, is the one that he cheat people, eat their wealth, eat their money. It, although he is praying and he is fasting, he deceives people. He gets their money, put it in his pocket and run away. He gets their wealth, put it in his pocket, run away. He backbite people. Like these two Sahabi, they came to Prophet ﷺ in the morning and they said, Ya Rasulullah, we have a stomach ache. And Sayyidina Muhammad ﷺ said, you ate raw meat this morning. They said, Ya Rasulullah, we never saw meat in our months and months. We are poor people. Alhamdulillah, here we eat meat every day. If there is no meat in the food, then no one will come to the mosque. Alhamdulillah, spiritual food and physical food, it's okay. But we eat meat. There are poor people, they don't see meat, go to countries other than here and see how people are living. I know people that they don't eat meat except from Eid to Eid, they have no money. So this Prophet ﷺ said to them, you ate raw meat in the morning. They said, Ya Rasulullah, we didn't see meat. He said, put your fingers in your mouth and vomit. They put and they vomited and raw meat was coming out. Raw meat, chunks of meat. They looked at each other, it's raw, it's with blood, and they have that meat inside their stomach from where it came. And Prophet said to them, today you backbited your Muslim brothers. You made fitna against them. You cheated them. You spoke badly about them. That's what you are, you ate the flesh of your brother. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prohibited it, to eat the flesh of the brothers and sisters. So, مَنْ لَا عَمَلَ لَهُ, as Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, al-muflis, not muflis in dunya from money, no, because he cheated everyone, he has money. But Allah take his prayers away, take his fasting away, take his hajj away, take his charity away, and throw him in hellfire. That was the punishment of that one who Prophet described as a bankrupt. So let us ask ourselves, are we struggling? We are bankrupted or not yet? We hope we are not bankrupted. That's why there is a struggle in ourselves between good and bad, always. There is a struggle. One of the wise men, one of the people who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them in Holy Quran, أَلَا إِنَّ أَوْلِيَاءَ اللَّهِ لَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ. Verily, awliya'ullah, friends of Allah, saints, they have nothing to fear. Those whose iman is strong and they become very crystal, very transparent, their heart very transparent. One of them said, you can see in every time there are many of them, these people who are very, very, very sincere, pious ones. The dunya is for them garbage. One time there was one famous, sincere, pious person that he is being mentioned in different books of Islam through different school of thoughts, not only the regular school of thought that you know. Most school of thought he was being mentioned, not most, all school of thought. And one day he was worshipping and saying, Ya Rabbi, open for you, for me my door, for your door, open for me your door, open for me your door. I want to come. It means I want your love. I want everything that feel in me is to love you. Means I want my whole body to be in love with you. That is not simple, that's not easy. It's very easy to love a girl and boy, and girl love a boy, and they don't eat and they don't drink because they love each other. It's not, especially if the parents are not accepting and the children are running after each other to love each other. You see them, they become sick even. And they don't eat, they become slim out of love. These pious people whom Allah mentioned them in Holy Quran are like that. They are so sincere, they're pious, that they become slim because their love to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is so great, you cannot imagine it. And he felt in himself as if a message came to him. Now we say, oh, how messages comes? It's easy, messages comes. We deny messages of heart and we accept messages of technology. Why we accept messages of technology and we don't accept messages of heart? Today, if you have a telephone, it's written on it, messages. And you can get a lot of messages or SMS or a message through the wavelength, the vibration of that phone, the cellular phone. Why our heart is not a cellular phone? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creation must be better than the invention of a human being. Why we believe in the invention of a human being and we do not believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creation? Sayyidina Umar was seeing and hearing. Sariya was hearing, but not seeing. Different levels. You can have a telephone that can see a picture and you can hear a voice. You can have a telephone that you can hear only a voice. Why we believe in technology and don't believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creation? As we receive messages on phones, we can receive messages through the heart. And the fact that pious person was feeling a message coming to his heart. Oh, Abu Yazid al-Bastami, you want to come my door? What you have done in order to be able to enter my door?
Allah.
He was hearing a message. Might be a message through his conscience. It's from unconscious to conscience and coming down to his heart. What you have done? And he's speaking to himself. Many people speak to themselves sometimes, no? They look at the mirror and they go, oh, I'm nice, I'm beautiful, I'm good, I'm handsome. Many people, every day, you look at yourself or not in the mirror. It's sunnah, don't be afraid. So Prophet used to look at himself in the mirror, so don't be worried. Look at yourself, no problem. Fix yourself very well, because it's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creation, it's okay. He's saying to himself, what you have done? And his self answered, oh, you left the whole dunya behind. You left dunya to go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He left the whole dunya. He said, Ya Rabbi, I'm coming to you. I'm leaving the whole dunya behind. Open for me your door. And he heard a message coming to his heart. What is this dunya that you are leaving behind? It doesn't weigh a wing of a mosquito to me. Prophet ﷺ said, "Inna dunya la tazinu janaha ba'uda," that the whole world does not weigh a wing of a mosquito to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He created it, and wing of a mosquito to him is more acceptable than the wealth of dunya. We are not saying the human being, we are saying the wealth of dunya, the treasures of dunya. So what you are leaving? The dunya? What I have to leave then, Ya Rabbi, speaking to himself. He said, leave yourself and come to me. Leave yourself and come to me. Don't come with yourself to me. I am La Sharika Lahu. I am the one that has no partner. I am the creator. Yourself is trying to trick you. Prophet ﷺ said, أخوف ما أخاف على أمتي الشرك الخفي. The most I fear for my ummah, the hidden shirk. The shirk that within us, that everything we think ourselves the best. You cannot accept opinion of others. No one can accept even a child, cannot accept even a child. His father and mother tell him something or tell her something, they say, oh, my mother and father, they are old style. They are, awkward people, backward people. We are modern people. We have technology. They don't accept their views, their opinions. Because everyone thinks himself, he knows everything. So Abu Yazid al-Bastani said, Ya Rabbi, I teach him. He said, leave yourself and come to me. Then I open my door for you. So that, we go back to that story, that wise man about backbiting. He said, if I want to backbite, because backbiting is not accepted. أَيُحِبُّ أَحَدُكُمْ أَنْ يَأْكُلَ لَحْمَ أَخِيهِ مَيْتًا فَكَرِهْتُمُوهُ. Allah said in the Holy Quran, any one of you likes to eat the flesh of his brother, that flesh of his brother, it is a disgusting thing. Means speaking badly about your brothers and sisters as if you are eating their flesh, Allah mentioned in the Holy Quran. And that man, he said, he's a wise man. He said, if I want to backbite, guess whom I am going to backbite? Anyone know? No. I don't know. Until I heard it. He said, if I want to backbite, I will backbite my father and my mother. You backbite usually people. You backbite your father and mother. He said, no, he's a sincere person, very pious person. He said, if I want to backbite, although he doesn't backbite, but he is giving some kind of education. If I want to backbite, I will backbite my father and my mother. And my children and my wife. Because I love them. I love them, I backbite them. Why? Because if I backbite them, it's better than to backbite someone other. Why? Because they can take my hasanat and I take their sayyat. Because I will give myself a scapegoat to them. I will sacrifice myself for them because I love them. So if I need to backbite, I don't go and backbite someone else. I go and backbite the one that I love, because then I make sure that he's going to take my hasanat, better someone foreigner to take my hasanat. And I will take his sayyat better than to for him, that person, to carry the sayyat. I will free him, and I will carry the sayyat of that person. Look how much sincerity we have people in Islam, that they teach us what we need to know and what we need to do. This man who said that is very, very well known Islamic history, and is accepted by every school of thought, like Abu Yazid al-Bastami, his name is Asir al-Saqafi. That he said that word, that I will backbite those whom I love, because then I give them my hasanah. I know it's not going to someone else. O Muslims, Islam is a taste. Islam is not a dry form. If we don't improve our character and our manners, we are lost. Although Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are praying, we are fasting, with His mercy He will send us to paradise, but we might be not in the paradise of prophets. We might not be accompanying prophet, might be in a different paradise. That is also a problem. Our dua must be, as Allah said in Holy Quran, Ya Rabbi, احشرنا مع الذين أنعمت عليهم من النبيين والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين. Oh Allah, resurrect us with those, with the نبيين, with the صديقين, with the شهداء, and with the صالحين. Don't leave us alone with no one by ourselves. So how to prevent that is, as Prophet said, don't be muflis, don't be bankrupted, don't be losing your properties. What are your properties? Are not the wealth of the dunya, but the wealth of akhirah. What you own is what you own in akhirah, not what we own in dunya. O Muslims, this world is ending. Don't think it's going to be too much. Prophet said, بُعِثْتُ وَالسَّاعَةَ هَتَيْنْ. I have been sent so near to the judgment day, like these two fingers are so near to each other. We are not far from, if Prophet said that, I have been sent near the judgment day, like these two fingers are near each other. Are we believing or not? Why we are coming to a mosque if we don't want to believe what Prophet ﷺ said? Why we are praying if we don't believe what Prophet said? So if he said, I have been sent so near to the judgment day, like these two fingers, means the judgment day might be tomorrow. Who knows? Might be this moment. How? To be this woman, might be Sayyidina Israel comes, take your soul, it's your judgment day.
Allah.
It's your day of death. It's the day that take you one step ahead to be in Barzakh in order to be near the judgment day. Means then you begin your process. The process of punishment or the process of paradise. The moment that Israel comes, is he coming with mercy or is he coming with punishment? There is one lady that also be mentioned in most of the schools of thought, is Rabi'a al-Adawiyya. And many people heard about her. Her husband died. She became pious after she got married. And when her husband died, she could continue her piety. So she was lonely, alone. So ulama came to her in a visit and they said, Ya Rabi'a, according to Islamic religion, to Sharia, you cannot be alone. You are a woman that with no husband, you have to marry. She said, I don't have time. I said, what, you don't have time? You have nothing to do. She said, no, I'm so busy. Busy in what? She said, I'm busy in istighfar. They said, are you not praying? She said, yes. Are you not fasting? Yes. You performed Hajj? Yes. Are you giving charity? Yes, if I have, I give. Hey, what you want more? She said, oh, you misunderstood me. Perhaps Allah did not accept my prayers. Perhaps Allah did not accept my fasting. Perhaps Allah did not accept my Hajj, because I'm always, when I say Allahu Akbar, my mind goes everywhere. Today when we are praying, whenever we pray, our mind goes from east to west. Everything about how our children doing in school, when they are going to graduate, when they're going to get a doctorate, medical degree, who is going to be married to, or what I'm going to do today, my job is what, my bank account is what kind of car I'm going to get. Everyone, all kind of gossips comes to his mind. She said, I'm busy in istighfar. They said, she cannot do that. You are busy, but you have to marry. She said, I will marry on one condition. And they said, what? She said, if anyone can answer my three questions, I would marry, I will have time for my husband. But now I don't have time, except day and night I have to keep istighfar, astaghfirullah. And they said, what are your questions? She said, first, if you can give me an answer for the first question, then I ask you the second question. They said, what is your first question? She said, when Allah wants to take my soul back, He is going to send Israel to me, correct? He said, yes, right. She said, is He going with mercy or is He going with punishment? Can you answer me? If He is going with mercy, this moment I will go and get married. If He is coming with punishment, means I need to keep istighfar. Means I need to be busy. Second question. When the two angels, Ankar and Nakir, come in the grave and ask me, who is Man Rabbuki? Who is your Lord? Who is your Creator? Who is your Prophet? What is your holy book? What is your religion? Can anyone answer me if they are coming with punishment or they are coming with mercy? Can anyone answer me if I will be able to speak to them or my tongue will be frozen? How they can answer? No answer. Then she said to him, third question, in the day of judgment, when Allah called me, come, Ya Amatullah, Ya Amatullah. Is He going to call me with His mercy or is He going to call me with punishment? They said, you keep doing astaghfirullah and we need to keep doing astaghfirullah. Oh Muslims, this is we learn from our ancestors, how they kept the taste of Islam. The taste of Islam that we today, we are not keeping it correctly. We are struggling, yes, we know that. But let us try our best to implement the practices of Islam that Prophet ﷺ mentioned in the relationship with everyone around us, relationship with people around us, building bridges with everyone, with every Muslim community, with Muslim and non-Muslim even. Prophet ﷺ never closed his door for non-Muslims, but his doors were open for non-Muslims. As his door were open for Muslims, his doors were open for non-Muslims. Might be also his doors were more wider for non-Muslim in order that they can enter in. And that's why we have to keep ourselves at our door 24 hours ready for non-Muslims. Might be they come into Islam, who knows? Why people are converting? We don't want to close the door of Islam in front of these people who are coming to Islam. We have to show them the majesty of Islam. We have to show them the love of Islam, the mercy of Islam, the good behaviors of Islam, the good manners, to share with them what we have, not to frighten them. Prophet ﷺ, 23 years to complete the message of Islam. We cannot give the message of Islam that Prophet gave to Sahaba 23 years in one day to a non-Muslim. Even to our children who are Muslim, we cannot give them the message of Islam in one day. What do you think about the non-Muslim? Oh Muslims, I will not be longer, it's enough. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us.
Amen.
And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us.
Amen.
And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala support us.
Amen.
And open for us His mercy.
Amen.
وَرَحْمَتِي وَسِعَتْ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ. My mercy has preceded everything. My mercy has encompassed everything. My mercy contained everything. We are from Ummatul Nabi, so we are contained in that rahmah. So we are not out of that rahmah. But let us honor that rahmah that Allah gave to us, not to go and try to abuse it by doing things that are not, Allah does not like them. When someone comes to you and tell you, can you loan me some money? You have to make sure you give him back his money. You cannot take it. How many people are facing problems today by cheating each other? And then they are not stopping, they are continuing and continuing and continuing and continuing. We are cheating ourselves. We are taking a loan from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, Ya Rabbi, did we sign a contract with Allah or not? We have signed a contract. When Allah called us in the day of promises, Alastu Rabbikum qalu bala, we said yes. In the day of promises, when Allah asked us, am I not your creator, we said yes. When we said yes, means we have signed. We have our signature there. When you do a contract, you are responsible for every letter in the contract. Today we want to buy a house in here. Do you have a contract of 20, 30 pages? You need 10 lawyers to read it for you. We have signed a contract in the day of promises, when Allah said, Alastu Rabbikum, what we said? Bala! We signed! Did we know what we signed? Allah has witnesses on what we signed. We have to fulfill what we signed. If we cannot fulfill, we are in breach of contract. We'll be asked. Oh Muslims, let us not to be breaching our contract with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah ordered us, ordered obligations that we have to do and forbid us from the mission to stop doing them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم ولسائر المستغفرين فيا فوز بالمستغفرين أستغفر الله حرمة الحبيب حرمة الفاتحة. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
Inshallah, we have live broadcast. Inshallah, we have.
All the time, that's a little live broadcast.
also watch. We like that time. It's always from the old brothers.
Is our time.